it's important for lawyers to know the person is coming from to try to build personal connection with the person or try to build like a specific relationship outside of business, because I feel like when it's too much, when it's business oriented, I feel like people start to draw off and they start to just not care and just, they think it's only about the case. Teaching category theory, I feel like it's important because I feel like we need to know where we come from. We need to know where we come from. We need to know where we come from. We need to know where we come from.
So bright, the mystery of their magic light that shines upon our heaven. Sleep upon my shoulder as we creep across the sand, so I may keep this memory of our caravan. This is so exciting. You are so inviting. Resting in my arms as I thrill to the thrilling magic of your charms. You here beneath the blue, my dreams of love are coming true. Within our desert caravan. Night, 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 and stars above that shine so bright. The mystery of their magic light that shines up on our caravan. Sleep upon my shoulder as we creep across the sand, so I may keep the memory of this caravan. Baby, you are so exciting, and you are so inviting. Resting in my arms as I thrill to the magic charm of you. Beside me here, beneath the blue, my dream of love is coming true. Within our desert caravan. Against my body, wrap your arms around me. I feel the magic of your charm, of you. Beside me here beneath the blue, my my dreams of love are coming true inside this desert If it's magic, why can't we make it everlasting? Like the sun that always shines. Like the poets in this rhyme. Like the galaxies in time. If it's pleasing, then why can't it be never leaving? Like the day that never fails. Like on seashores there are shells. Like the time that always tells. It holds a key to every heart throughout the universe. It fills you up without a bite and quenches every thirst. So, if it's special, then with it, why aren't we as careful as making sure we dress in style, as posing pictures with a smile, keeping danger from a child. It holds the key to every heart throughout the universe. It fills you up without a bite and quenches every thirst. So, if it's magic, why can't we make it everlasting, like the lifetime of the sun? It will leave no harm undone. There is enough for everyone. Thank you. Thank you so much. This is magic. It's taken us a bit of an effort to be here, but we're here. And it's so nice to see so many of you, so many people I love and who I know love me. I'm on a love thing this year. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. So, welcome to this evening of critical race music. I feel privileged and fortunate to be sharing the stage with the CRTrio, I'm calling them. And I'd like you to meet them. On the piano is Victor Gould. And on the drums, we have Nasheet Waits. And at the bass fiddle, Yasushi Nakamura. So we've put together a set of songs that I like, but that I also think, for me, represent the musical counterpart of critical race theory. In fact, I like to think of some of these songs, at least for me, as the soundtrack of critical race theory. So we started with a wonderful composition, a classic in the jazz canon by Juan Tizol and Duke Ellington, Caravan, followed, of course, by Stevie Wonder's lovely composition, If It's Magic. And we're going to move on to a blues. Audio clip, please.
You know, I'm not a black man, but I am a black woman, and I do have black male family, so my brother and my father. I remember growing up, I think I must have been around 13 or so, my dad got a brand new car. It was very sleek, black, and I just remember him coming home time and time again saying, okay, I got stopped again. The police stopped me. And it was really for nothing other than to just make sure that he actually owned the car or shouldn't use the car. And of course, he owned the car. But it got so bad that it was actually interfering with his like day-to-day life. Like he had to get to work and he's being stopped, which takes up time, obviously. And it's obviously an uncomfortable situation. So it actually got to the point where he, you know, said to my mom one day, like, you know, we gotta switch cars. I need to drive your car because this isn't working for me. So of course, you know, my mom got a sweet deal out of it. But I just remember thinking like, are you kidding me? Like, this is what it's come to? Like, you can't drive your car? And it was kind of heartbreaking in the sense that he said it just like, matter-of-factly, like, this is what we have to do.
Long before the Innocence Project, a blues singer named Ed Bell wrote a song called My Crime Blues, we'd like to do for you now. I got the blues for my baby, and my baby's got the blues for me. Well, I've got the blues for my baby, and my baby has got the blues for me. But I can't see my baby, and my baby can't see me. I'm gonna be condemned early tomorrow morning. Well, I am going to be condemned early, early tomorrow morning. But I am not guilty, 'cause I ain't done nobody wrong. My crime, I said I really don't understand. No, 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 my crime, I really don't understand. You see, they got me excused of murder, but I ain't never, never harmed a man. Take it away, Victor. Tell my mother not to weep. Tell my sister and brother not to moan. Tell my mother not to weep. Tell my brother and my sister to don't moan. Tell my father to find somebody, somebody who can go my bond. Baby, please come down on my trial day. Will you please come on down to the courthouse on my trial day? So when I be condemned, you can wipe my tears away. You know the jury found me guilty, but the judge say, listen here, the jury found me guilty, but the judge say, listen here. For you, get ready, for the electric chair. My crime, blues, The clips that you're hearing are just a taste of a feast that students in the Critical Race Theory Seminar Workshop that I teach up at Columbia Law School with my dear brother, Floris Forbes. Floris, where are you? Let me hear you. Where you at? I know he's here. Floris and I have been teaching the course together for 3 years. And over the course of it, he has become my teacher. And this year, largely because of his example, we were able to get 7 extraordinary folks from our community who served as podcast consultants for the students who were in the Critical Race Theory Seminar that just ended in the fall semester. All of them had direct lived experience of the criminal punishment system. I don't call it the criminal justice system because it ain't got nothing to do with justice. And over the course of the semester, we created a learning community that's part of a larger network of teaching and research and writing that's going on at Columbia around the human rights atrocity that is the American carceral system. And My Crime Blues, for me, really captures the roots of the work that is going on, not just at Columbia, but all over this country, of critical resistance to the epidemic of incarceration and surveillance and policing and violence that take place all over these United States every day. We are trying at Columbia in the seminar that Forrest and I do to look at critical race theory through an abolitionist lens, but also a reconstructionist lens that tries to imagine a different future, because a different future is possible if we're willing and courageous enough to open ourselves up to it. We're going to move on to a song that is a classic in the American popular songbook. I haven't done a Google search on how many recordings of this song there are, but there are a lot. But I'm singing it tonight because it's part of the archive of popular songs that originated in Broadway musicals and migrated to very different stages to do important cultural work. Tony Bennett sang this song in 1965, the night before the final leg of the third march from Selma to Montgomery. Harry Belafonte organized a Night of the Stars rally. It was a star-studded event. And Tony Bennett sang this song. The next day, I believe it was, he was taken to the airport by a union worker, union organizer, who had come down from Detroit, named Viola Luzzo. Like Bennett, Italian-American. And on her way back from the airport, she was murdered by racists who saw her driving a car in which the passenger seated next to her was a young local black activist. Bennett sang this song, and it takes on a new meaning when you consider that it is part of a freedom struggle soundtrack, just in time. Just in time, you found me just in time. Before you came, my time was running low. I was lost, the losing dice were tossed, my bridges all were crossed, I had nowhere to go. But now you are here, and I know just where I'm going. No more doubt or fear, I found my way. I found you just in time. Love found me just in time and changed my lonely life that lucky day. Just in time, I found you just in time. Before you came, my time was running low. I was lost, the losing dice were tossed, every one of my bridges crossed, I had nowhere to go. But now you are here, I know where I'm going. Through my doubt, through my fear, I found my way. Just in time, you found me just in time, and changed my lonely life that lovely day. Just in time, I found you just in time before you came, baby. My time was running low. I was lost, the losing dice were tossed. My bridges burned and crossed. I had nowhere to go. But right now, right now, right now, you're here. And I know where I'm going. Through my doubt, through my fear, I found a way out of no way, just in time. You found me just in time. You changed my lonely life that lucky day. You changed my lonely life just in time. Just in time. Just in time. In the nick of time. Yeah, 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 just in time. Just in time. Justin, Justin, you were right on, right on, right on time. Just in time, 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 just in time. You changed my lonely life, 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 that love. Day. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Oh, thank you. Yolanda, my dear cousin, she was the first of my cousins to move to New York. She came right out of college and slept on my apartment floor for a few months. And thank you, Yolanda. And we live across the street from each other these days. Our great-grandmother, Eva Mae Washington, who lived in East Chicago, Indiana, which is where I was born, lived next door to her big sister, whom I knew as Aunt Levy. And they would sit on the porch. They modeled critical race theory for me. We didn't have the word. They would sit on the porch every week, each with their own copy of the Chicago Defender, arguing across the porch. Right? And modeled for me the rigor of the intellectual culture of black women. And Yolanda and I, we don't do quite that. We have our fair share of arguments. They're not arguments. We discuss things like Big Mama did. But I'm so fortunate to have her here. And we were recently welcomed in the last year by my niece, Michaela, who's here, who moved to New York from Sacramento. She's going to, she's studying art here in New York City. And just last week, my cousin Timothy moved here from Nashville. So we got some kinfolk in New York. Can you cue up the next audio clip?
A lot of social psychologists recently have been studying on the issue of how whites perceive Black children. And there are a lot of studies where they will show people pictures of children. Some of them deal with law enforcement people, folks as participants, and they ask them to guess the age of the children. And by and large, children of color and Black children, it's the disparities are the worst. There's always an overestimation of the age of children of color in those studies. Black boys have the highest disparity. It's really hard for people to grasp the concept of a Black male child as being a child and what all of that means in terms of social construction, that they're not dangerous, they're innocent, they should be given multiple chances and the benefit of the doubt, we can forgive their transgressions, they're not intending to harm even if they commit a harm. So those, you know, we treat children that way, but if we're imagining these Black kids and Black boys in particular as adults, then we don't give them that type of benefit of the doubt. It's really hard for people to grasp the concept of a Black male child.
Out of the night, soft as the dawn, into the light, this child, soft as a fawn, innocent child, a child is born, one small heart, one pair of eyes, one work of art, here in my arms, here he lies. Trusting and warm, blessed this morn, a child is born. Ooh, child, things are gonna get easier. Ooh, child, things will get brighter, brighter. Ooh, child, things are gonna get easier. Ooh, child, things will get brighter. Someday we will walk in the rays of a beautiful sun. Someday get together and get it undone. Someday we'll walk in the rays of a beautiful sun. Yes, we will. Someday, one day, the world will get brighter. One small heart, one pair of eyes, one work of art. here in my arms, there he lies, trusting and warm. Blessed this morn, a child is born. It's Sunday, and although I can't say I was in church this morning, I hear you, Marsha. Marsha wasn't in church either. The month of February often finds me remembering the come Sunday days of my childhood and youth, mostly because there are three February birthdays in my family. My mother was born on the 19th of February. My grandmother, who was an awesome singer and who I feel myself channeling the older I get every time I open my mouth to sing, was born on the 21st of February, and I was born on the 22nd of February. So my mind goes back to my experiences listening to my grandmother singing while she was frying chicken or baking biscuits in the kitchen. She sang all the time, and I picked up that habit. Folk look at me strange sometimes. That's all right. Mama said it was okay to sing wherever you go, because what does the song say? Without a song, the day would never end. Huh? So my experience with the Black Church and the music of the Black church was an experience of critical race literacy in song, right? So music making in the Black church is not a performance. It's literally called service, right? And I was, from the time I was 12 years old until I was 17, the musical director, that's what the choir director, that's what they call it. We didn't have the choir director at the church my grandfather pastored, the Ora Vista Missionary Baptist Church in Oroville, California. And I would play at 11:15 at my grandfather's church right after playing at 10 o'clock for an all-white, totally segregated church up on a hill, the Trinity Presbyterian Church, where my voice teacher, Winifred Sloop Hills, was the music director. So I shuttled back and forth, literally, between these two experiences of church. And sometimes I would hear at Trinity Presbyterian Church a song that we did a whole nother way down at Ora Vista. They would, and it was my musical link to the political theology of Black liberation. These were songs, as they were sung when I was a child, that were reimagined, reworked, rewritten, reinvented. And my favorite example of how the liberation aesthetics of Black church music are encapsulated in the uses of European songs is a song that will be familiar to most of you, written by an English slave trader. Give me that E. And this is how we would have sung it at Ora Vista. They always started with an Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. This was congregational music. So someone would line, and then the congregation would say, that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Oh Lord, once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was blind, but now I see. Sunday morning, just before the death of day, all the family friends were grieving. Reverend Jones had just passed away. Sister Jones had seen it coming. She was familiar with the sign. Sometimes you could see her walking, wailing through the Georgia pines. She said, Lord, if you take him away, I don't want to live. It was early Sunday morning, just before the birth of day. Sister Jones, I can hear the rooster crow. Sister Jones knelt down to pray. She said, Lord, he's slipping through my fingers. Is death a master of us all? I'm bowed down humble here before you. Spare his life, don't let him fall. She said, Lord, don't take him away. If you do, I won't live another day. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Burden down, burden down. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burden down, it was later on that same Sunday evening, just before the midnight bell, Sister Jones was heavy breathing. I can still hear her morning song. Life was crying from her body like water from a drying well. Well, I heard her whisper, "Thank you, Jesus," just before the midnight bell. Sister Jones was taken away. She didn't live another day. Sister Jones was taken away. She didn't live. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I laid my burden down. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burden down. In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise. Sushi and Ashit and I are going to do a song for you now, written by Little Willie John, who wrote a song that you will immediately recognize. I'm just going to put a little snippet of it in the middle of another song. Little Willie John is part of the long lineage of mostly black music makers who spent time in jail. Our colleague Sarah Haley in the history department at Columbia has written a beautiful book about the prison system in Georgia, in which she devotes a whole chapter to the ways in which the blues became a site and a source of resistance by black women who were arrested and imprisoned and exploited as laborers in Georgia prisons. This song is not about prison, but Little Willie John had many, many hits in the 1950s. And if I can say this, a whole lot of folk made a whole lot of money off of Little Willie John that Willie himself never saw. So we're going to do this song. He died in a prison in Washington State. And we need to tell more of the backstories of these songs. These songs are not just about entertainment. They are the sedimented history of struggle and suffering and resistance, even when they're about love, right? My love is a mountainside. It's so firm it can calm the tide. My love for you is a mountainside, stand so firm it can calm the tide. I said, my love is a mountainside. Well, my love is an ocean roar. So strong that it won't let me go. My love for you is an ocean roar. Grow so strong that it won't let me go. I said, my love is an ocean roar. My love is longer than forever, endless as the moors of time. So 99 years after never, in my heart you'll still be mine. I said, my love is a deep blue sea. So deep that I'll never be free. My love for you is a deep blue sea. Pulls me so deep I'll never be free. That's why my love is a deep blue sea. My love is brighter than a thousand suns, hotter than a day in July. My love for you has no horizon. Baby, you know the reason why. You give me fever when you kiss me, fever when you hold me tight. Fever in the morning, fever all through the night. I said, my love is a deep blue sea. So deep that I'll never be free. My love for you is a deep blue sea. Pull so deep that I'll never be free. That's why my love is a deep blue sea. Mm-hmm, my love. My love, my love, my love, my love, my love. My love, 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 my love.
Thank you. We're going to turn to a song that gives us a pre-Stonewall snapshot of queer culture that channels and innovates the black music we call jazz. It's a song by the great Billy Strayhorn, who was the musical partner of Duke Ellington and who wrote so many brilliant songs. It was hard deciding which one to choose, but this one is particularly poignant because he wrote it when he was in his teens, and the lyric alone, the poetry of the lyric alone is just astonishing. He was a wunderkind, but the music is even more extraordinary. No one had ever written a song like this before Strayhorn sat down and wrote this one. It's queer Afro-pessimism meets, I am an intellectual, you have to give me a break, huh? Queer Afro-pessimism meets the jazz art song. and we'd like to do it for you now. I used to visit all the very gay places, those come what may places, where one relaxes on the axis of the wheel of life to get the feel of life from jazz and cocktails. The girls I knew had sad and sullen gray faces with distingue traces. They used to be there, you could see where they'd been washed away by too many through the day. 12 o'clock tales. Then you came along with your siren song to tempt me to madness. I thought for a while your poignant smile was tinged with the sadness of a great love for me. But I was wrong again. So very again, a trough full of hearts could only be a bore. Life is lonely again. Only last year, everything seemed so sure. A week in Paris would ease the bite of it. All I care is to smile in spite of it. I'll forget you, yes I will, while yet you are still burning inside my brain. Romance is a mush, stifling those who strive. I live a lush life in some small dive, and there I will be while I rot with the rest of those whose lives are lonely too. Thank you. Yes, I will. Why yet you are still burning inside of my brain, my brain. Romance is mush, stifling those who strive. I'll live a lush life in some small dive, and there I'll be while I rot with the rest of those who lives are lonely too. Thank you. Title of this song always reminds me of Governor Ron DeSantis. I want to dedicate this to him. Song made famous by Fats Waller. Just be true. Just be true. When you say, I love you, it's a sin to tell a lie. Millions of hearts have been broken just because these words were spoken. I love you. Yes, I do. I love you. If you break my heart, I'll die. So be true. Be sure that it's true when you say, I love you. 'Cause it's a sin to tell a lie. Just be true. When you say that I love you, it's a sin to tell a lie. Millions of hearts have been broken just because these three little words were spoken. Baby, I love you. Yes, I do. I love you. If you break my heart, I'll die. So be sure that it's true when you say I love you, 'cause it's a sin to tell a lie. Stop lying on CRT. Stop your culture war hypocrisy. It's a sin. Yes, it is. It's a sin and a shame how you scandalize my name. Just stop it with your sun-kissed fascist lies. It's a sin to tell a lie. You a lie and the truth ain't in you. This is a song by Bob Marley. Until the philosophy that holds one race superior and another inferior is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned. Everywhere is war. That until there are no longer first and second class citizens of any nation, until the color of our skin is of no more significance than the color of our eyes, until the basic human rights are equally guaranteed to all without regard to race, this a war. That until that day, the dream of lasting peace, world citizenship, and the rule of international morality will remain but a fleeting illusion to be pursued, but never, ever attained. I say war. And until the ignoble and unhappy regimes that hold our brothers and sisters in Angola, Mozambique, South Africa, Memphis, Ferguson, Baltimore have been totally destroyed, toppled and destroyed. Well, everywhere we say war in the East, war in the West, war up north and war down south, war, rumors of war. Until that day, the African continent will not know peace. We Africans shall fight We find it necessary, and we know we shall win, as we are confident in the victory of good over evil, of good over evil. War, war, good over evil. I say war in the east, in the west, in the north, in the south, war. See, we want freedom. Oh, freedom, 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 freedom. Everywhere there'll be war. Freedom, war. Freedom, yeah, yeah. We who believe in freedom shall not rest until it comes. I said we who believe in freedom shall not rest until it comes. Freedom, 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 freedom. Yeah. We have to leave you. We have to leave you. We're going to leave you with a song that was written by a Bronx school teacher by the name of Abel Maripol and made famous by Billie Holiday. Thank you so much for coming out. Thank you to Joe's Pub. Thank you to this wonderful staff. Tip them well. I'd like to thank Victor Gould, Nasheed Waits, and Yasushi Nakamura. Get home safe. Southern trees bear a strange, strange fruit, blood on the leaves and blood at the black body swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar tree. Pastoral scene of the gallant South, the bulging eyes and the twisted scent of magnolia, sweet and fresh, and the sudden stench of burning flesh. Here is a fruit for the crows to plough, for the rain to gather, for the wind to suck, for the sun to rot, for the tree drop. Here is a strange and bitter and bitter.